So good morning, everybody. We're taping on this Friday, June 14th at a home office in Canterbury. And this podcast will be a series of updates we're doing on the Brunswick Independent Authors Association. And I have a very special person sitting down with us today. I say very special because I consider him still one of the best young journalists of the last decade in New Brunswick. I've known him for almost half your life, technically.
Probably, yeah. Somewhere there
goes. He's your friend and ours, former award-winning reporter with the Bugle Observer, with our best paper in Canada, best in Atlantic years in the early 2010s. Nathan is probably one of the most important writers coming from the Woodstock region, again, after the past decade. Very dedicated news reporter, very good at sports. When I was running a sports section at the Bugle, he was sort of my, say like Star Trek, my number one. And he was, in my memory, the youngest beat reporter for the Maritime Hockey League, which is considered one of the most prestigious junior A leagues in Canada, covering the Woodstock Slammers. And Nathan has also had some experience on the university level in various means. He's now a reporter with our great award-winning newspaper, the Miramichi Leader. Nathan, good morning. How's everything today? How you like the home office here in Canterbury?
Morning, Jeffrey. It's great to be here. It's a nice little spot, actually. You've got a nice setup here at the home office in Canterbury. Yeah, I like it.
The acoustics are really good. And Nathan has a good radio voice, so Nathan's like me. You don't have to turn up the volume. So, so Nathan, your writing career goes way back, and I know you were inspired in your teens to take up writing. We remember in Woodstock you were one of the most read bloggers in Woodstock, and you were telling me that's pretty well where you got your official start as an unpaid writer.
As an unpaid writer, yes. I was published, though, at age 14 with Platinum Magazine in Fredericton, as well as their short-lived newspaper, The River Region Reporter. My inspiration, I guess, came from just my lifelong love for media and storytelling and the community and the world around me. At a very young age, I was publishing a newspaper that I wrote by hand for my grandmother DeLong and family members. So I go way back as far as writing. It's something I've always loved. It's always been a hobby of mine. I now write for a living as well as a hobby. So.
Well, we remember Nathan well because he was one of a number of journalists, including he wasn't kind of a paid journalist, but there was Nathan, Derek Crony, myself, I think Jason Wilson might have been. I don't think you work with Jason, but there was different people covering the Slammers on a regular basis. CJ, and he was there as a blogger for his blog. And your name or blog, just for people who don't remember,
the Shiretown Blogger.
Now, how long did you do that? It was 3 years, 4 years?
About 2 years, actually.
Is it still available online? There's some interesting stories still up on that, eh?
Yeah, all my content is still up. I think it's shiretownblogger.blogspot.com, or maybe it's .ca. I don't remember the exact URL, but I do know it's still out there, and you can see where I got my start. I mean, I guess, folks, you've got to start somewhere, so...
So you came to the attention of the Bugle, and I think Jim and Devin were still there?
Yes, they were. It was around the tail end of my stint writing with Platinum, and Maxson and Associates was the publisher in Fredericton. It was near the tail end of my stint with them. I published an article about the history of the Woodstock Victorian Christmas, now called First Town Christmas Festivities. I think that was November of 2010. So I was a small part in that team award for the newspaper.
Well, we're very lucky because that year we had Nathan and different correspondents, columnists. We had six or seven columnists. But your first official photo assignment, you talked about that. That's kind of one of your legends. All the journalists locally, we talk about that. Talk about your first photo assignment with the Bugle, and this is something most journalists can relate to. Talk about that. The famous wrong time incident.
Yeah. Yeah, some folks who have been at the Bugle Observer for a long time would remember this, but I was taking photos with my little Sony point-and-shoot camera that I used at the time. This would have been in June of 2012 at the Woodstock High School prom parade. I had been invited by a friend to attend the graduation that year as well, but the prom is where I guess I got my first major photo spread assignment, if you will. And oftentimes in journalism, when one door closes, another one opens, whether that's for you or, you know, for anyone else, really. So what happened was Brian Tate, who was a reporter at the Bugle Observer at the time, had been told the wrong time for when the parade was going to start, and by the time he got there, it was over. But he saw that I had shot some photos of my friends who were attending the prom for my blog and for Facebook, and after I shared them on Facebook, he contacted me and said, "Hey, I was told the wrong time. You know, would you be willing to send some of your photos, and we'll pay you as a freelancer?" So I guess one assignment led to another, and the rest was history, as they say.
And I can tell you Nathan was a great addition. He called that junior reporter. That's not a misnomer, because we, when you're a junior reporter, he sees something in you like a, what do you call it, a copy boy or whatever. Now, Nathan, what really came successful, and when I started to have some vision issues and some diabetic issues, which eventually led me to retire from the Bugle, what Nathan did, and we agreed with Jim Dunville, the editor, he would take over the beat reporting into Woodstock Slammers. How many hours a week were you putting into the Slammer coverage? It was like between 8 and 12 hours a week,
give or take. Yeah, between game coverage, that'd probably be a 3 or 4 hour night at least, to previews that I'd write, you know, during the week, and
two editions,
the odd player profile, too.
Two editions for Bugle every week. Now, Nathan, working on the beat and basically making connections with the coaching staff, the players, what did that do to enhance your appreciation of writing as a reporter and as a sports reporter?
A big thing about journalism, too, is that you are often encouraged to read what other people write and develop your own style, and that's what I did from a young age. I was that weird kid in high school who, you know, cared about the outside world and read the paper cover to cover. So, obviously, reading other people's work and, you know, styles helped me develop my own, but actually being a hands-on part of the sports coverage, mainly with the Woodstock Slammers at the time in the 2012-2013 season.
Which was another big year for the Slammers.
That was the year after their memorable run to
second place at
RBC Cup. Yeah, after they won the league in the Fred Page Cup. They won the league, and I remember it was in triple overtime in Game 7 on home ice over the Yarmouth Mariners. I think it was 4-3, and that Robert Viska scored the overtime winner.
Yeah.
And I was there as the Shiretown blogger to cover the game. And the year after that was when I took it on for the Bugle Observer and stopped doing the blog once I had to focus on that full time. But one thing I found, though, by building connections with the coaching staff is, like, the whole experience just taught me a whole new appreciation for sports journalism when you see firsthand the roller coaster of emotions that goes into a sports game and whatnot.
Yeah, see what Nathan used to put together, and I'm not scared to say this. I've read very, very poor copy as an editor. I've put together stories out of really poor copy. Nathan would give me copy was almost like a gourmet meal with perfect ice cream for dessert and a fortune cookie besides. It was easy to read. The flow was perfect, and I get not say jealous, but I would say if I wrote like you at your age, because when I was his age, I couldn't write like him because I was still in college learning my trade, and it was a pleasure to read because you could see his appreciation of what he was covering into words. Because there's two types of writers out there, ladies and gentlemen: people that don't appreciate their subject, and people that don't go through the motions. People do it justice, and if you have a chance, I think the Bugle Archive is not up, eh? But if you have the Irving subscription, if you put in his name in relation to the archive, you'll see what I mean. And that's why the association is very glad to have him, because he's not only a person that has almost a decade of experience as a published author, he can kind of motivate others to seek the best appreciation and way to put together words on paper. Now, from there, of course, university beckoned. Talk a little bit about that.
For 4 years, I attended St. Thomas University in Fredericton. I took, a four-year Bachelor of Arts degree is what I obtained, but I took the double major in journalism and communications and public policy, so a fair bit of overlap in both of those areas, but different kinds of writing in those fields as well, because in journalism, obviously, you're writing for your reader, and to share as much information as possible in as clear and concise of a way and as in often as short of a time as possible, or in as little space as possible, but presenting the facts in a way that are, you know, unbiased, you know, without your opinion clearly showing, so that you can try to, you know, encourage your readers to come to their own conclusions. You know, there's a bit similar in communications and policy writing, although you're writing, you know, for government or for an organization or on behalf of an organization or that type of thing. But great experience. I attended for 4 years. I volunteered and was a staff reporter and sports editor at the STU and the UNB campus papers.
The Aquinian, yeah.
Yeah, I was a volunteer at the Aquinian at St. Thomas my first 2 years there.
Which is a very good paper, by the way.
Yeah, it is. It's a great experience for any young journalist who's looking to get experience in bylines. In my third year at St. Thomas, I was a staff writer at the Brunswick Inn at UNB. And that was back when they still had that was actually the last year that they had a print version weekly. Now they have a leaflet they publish monthly that's more on the human interest side, and their news and stuff goes on their website weekly or as it breaks. And then fourth year, I went back to my roots, if you will, at St. Thomas, and was a sports editor at the Aquinian, and I covered the St. Thomas Tommies women's hockey team and championship at the men's volleyball program, and you know, several other, you know, athletes and sports teams at STU.
And you were summering with us, too.
Yeah, oh my goodness, that's the biggest, you know, part of my resume, if you will, as far as cutting my teeth goes. I mean, as I said earlier, one door closes, another one opens, whether it's with you or with another person. I mean, Jeffrey's health took a turn for the worse right around 2012 or 13.
Yeah, yeah. Well, I went blind.
I was fresh out of high school.
And I went blind, and I said to myself, okay, at least Nathan is there. That was the only good part. I did get my vision back, but I had no qualms to say Nathan could take the baton and run with it, especially in sports coverage, because not to say we think alike, but we're on the same mindset of what they call player celebration and player like hometown hero style of writing. Because when Nathan writes something, he puts his heart into it because he wants to show the heart of the subject he's writing about.
Yeah, and I mean, I was the week after it was a few days after I graduated high school. It would have been less than a week after I got my diploma. I was on as a summer student for the Bugle Observer after working there as a co-op student in the fall semester of my grade 12 year and as a full-time freelancer, I guess due to a staffing shortage and, you know, just the need for an extra body to help out with some weekend coverage and sports and the whole nine yards. But, yeah, one summer internship led to another, so one summer internship fresh out of high school at the Bugle Observer quickly turned into five. So I kept coming back, yep, thanks to support from then editor Jim Dumville and other, yep, colleagues. And yep, I worked there 2013, would have been 14, 15, 16, and 17 when I was fresh out of university. I graduated from St. Thomas in 2017, and I was at the Bugle Observer that summer before I got an opportunity for an internship extension, they called it at the time, at the Telegraph Journal in St. John,
yep,
one of our sister papers in the company and the flagship provincial paper of Brunswick News as well. I worked there for about 5 months, and then a full-time opportunity come up in Miramichi, yeah, so at the Miramichi Leader. So I was blessed to have been offered that position, be able to take it and to, you know, establish roots up there as well. So that's my adopted home, but don't worry, folks, I haven't forgotten about my roots in Carlton and Northern New York County. I often tell people that my old stomping grounds in this region cover a pretty vast territory, given the amount of times I crisscrossed the region for work.
Now, we're talking a little bit about the sports coverage. Unfortunately, with the community papers of Brunswick News, they've decided not to have the massive sports sections that Nathan and I used to put together, and Jason Wilson and different people. When Nathan was in his early years, the Bugle sports sections could be as many as 16 pages a week, and Nathan had two-page spreads on the Bugle, wherever sports he was covering. We don't see it as much, and we kind of missed that time, too, because he mentioned about the Brunswick and the papers involved with the group. There's been some layout changes, but in the height where we won best sports coverage in Canada, which was Nathan was a contributing factor of that, again, we were 14 to 16 pages. You don't see that anymore, because how many people can say a regional population of 20,000 16 pages? But you need reporters like Nathan, reporters like myself or editors or whatever. So getting back to the Miramichi Leader, your duties with the Leader, and the Leader is considered one of the, still one of the best community papers in Canada, won many awards under David Cadogan's tenure and beyond. So your duties there, it's multifaceted.
It is. I mean, I do everything from news reporting to, you know, community stories, human interests, a lot of sports, actually. I've been really fortunate to be able to take on the New Brunswick Senior Baseball League and the New Brunswick Junior Baseball League.
Baseball, yeah.
Yeah, we're getting into the heart of baseball season now, and you know, I've even gotten opportunities to cover the Miramichi Valley Baseball League, the Intermediate A circuit up around there that includes about four or five teams from Northeast New Brunswick. I mean, that's been a great experience. I've been able to get back on the Junior A beat as well with Maritime Hockey League during
the winter.
The Miramichi Timberwolves, they're celebrating their 20th season this year. So, I've gotten opportunities to do that, and I've been actually delighted and blessed to be back on the Maritime Hockey League beat where I started.
See, not to show my age, I covered the announcement of the Timberwolves joining the league because the Rusgush River Rats were part of the association for a little while up home. And if my memory serves, when Campbellton dropped out, Miramichi kind of showed up to fill that North Shore void. Now, Nathan, this is the first of several podcasts we're doing with you. This is sort of like an interview process. We're going to be doing it with the other authors as well to talk about it. The next podcast, we're going to talk about Nathan's book. Sorry, I didn't mention earlier, but he's working on a book of the history of Woodstock. He always has an opportunity to... one thing I like about you, Nathan, I hope you take it the right way, your research skills are tremendous because a young journalist or any journalist, it doesn't do the research. You're flying with only one wing. Maybe talk about that very quickly before we get next podcast, the importance for young writers to be prepared to write before they write.
Attention to detail is everything, too. I mean, like Jeffrey talked about earlier, singing the praises about the copy I filed and whatnot. I mean, somebody's got to edit that stuff. So, I mean, like, put your best foot forward and always do your best work. And if you have a God-given gift and talent, I mean, you got to defend that honor. But, I got the opportunity while I was at university to learn a lot about research and took a couple research methods and, ethics communications classes. And that's a whole other story. But, getting that experience, I guess, in academia for 4 years definitely helped as far as my research skills go above and beyond, you know, the day-to-day journalism that I do.
So this goes for any writer or author or poetry or short story. The more education, either in class or what do you call social education, you must have experiences that you can form into thoughts. You can put down on paper and be prepared. It really has nothing to do with perfect grammar. It has to do with an appreciation. I tell you why.
Appreciation for the subject matter. Right.
I'll give an example. He's a colleague of us. The former mayor of Beldoon, Andy Flanagan, a little shout out to my crew up North Shore, did a book on the Hong Kong veterans about the Battle of Hong Kong. He took his father's diary and the experiences of other survivors and actually people who passed away, their families' views on the Hong Kong occupation, and put a book together. It's considered probably one of the top 10 military books and maritime history over the last 20 years, a tremendous book. He told me many years ago, he said, you know, a journalist and a writer, you got to research, you got to know what you're talking about. Every word you put on paper can't be wasted because, for example, in the mantra I gave Nathan, different people, you're going to write a column, make it around 600 words. If it's something more important, it can be longer. Listen, I used to edit Gwyn Dyer's copy, and he used to write 800-900 words, and it was all these background paragraphs was fine, but even Gwyn Dyer would have a run-on. To be a good writer, you have to be a good editor as well, either self-edit or practice. And what Nathan mentioned, different writers inspired him. Like when I was growing up, it was actually, a little shout-out to Nathan, Miramichi Leader had somebody called Doug Underhill, which is a very good writer. McGuire, I think, at the Telegraph.
Peter
McGuire. I mimicked their style a little bit, and Nathan's done the same. Nathan, you probably read certain copy that you said, who in the heck wrote this?
Oh, yes.
Yeah.
I have. Been there and done that.
Yeah, because he writes in a way where he's basically, you have to write for yourself as a writer, but you have to write for other people, and that's where any author is listening to it. You can't just write for yourself. You got to have something to draw in people, and that's what we're going to try to do with the association, to share these tips that we've learned with the younger ones coming up. So Nathan, the first podcast, not too painful?
Not at all.
Yeah, it's like a flu shot to me today. So number two, we're going to talk, coming up, we're going to talk about the book and the title. We're giving a preview here. So you can take your orders now. Anybody listening, call Nathan, saying whatever the book comes out.
Yeah.
You can book with Nathan ahead. Doesn't hurt. Consider this like, you know, a Dixie Lee where you're calling in your meal or something like that.
Yeah, feel free. I mean, if you're interested in copies, you know, of my book on history of the Woodstock area, by all means, contact me on Facebook, on Twitter, email me, or what have you, really. I mean, I'm on a few different social platforms.
Nathan DeLong Book, and I think Nathan DeLong...
Yeah, it's my Facebook page.
Nathan DeLong Membership Leader as well?
No, my media page, actually, that I should start using more again is Nathan DeLong Media.
Yeah. But Nathan DeLong Book, you'll see his smiling face.
Those are on Facebook, by the way.
Yeah, on Facebook. And don't forget New Brunswick Independent Authors Association. It is a closed group right now, but we take joining requests. Please contact me on Facebook, JJ Carrier or New Brunswick Independent Authors Association, and we'll be glad to hear from you. Nathan, thanks so much. Part one, part two is coming up very soon. And like I said, as we say in the North Shore, keep your stick in the ice. Have a good one. Bye.